we need to start making more conscious material choices.
We set up an initiative called Make Fashion Circular.
It's a tsunami of change.
Hello and welcome to the Ellen MacArthur Foundation's DIFF, the online festival of ideas that aims to shift mindsets and inspire action toward a circular economy. My name's Colin and I'm the host of this session. Interactive as always, so please put your thoughts and comments and questions about this session into the chat box you're watching this session on. Now, by 2050, 80% of the world's food will be consumed inside of cities. A growing world population coupled with an unhealthy food system makes for a perfect storm. But the DIFF isn't the place for airing just problems, it's a place for solutions. And we've got a solution, or a potential solution anyway, here for you today. Joining me in the studio is Alessandro Grampa, who's one of the founders of Hexagro, who thinks that we should be growing more of our food at home or around us in our offices. Alessandro, thanks very much for joining us.
Hi there.
Why do you think we should be growing food inside our cities?
Well, I mean, the answer is multiple. In general, as you mentioned, we're all most going to be living into cities. So people are not going to be living in countryside. And then the question is either who's going to produce the food that currently is produced there and is going to bring it into cities, or how do we actually just produce it in the places where we are? And specifically the fact that right now all the food that is produced outside of cities needs to come into cities. And within this process, the value chain, we lose almost 50% of the food we produce. So that's a shame. And there are still people missing food to eat at the end of the day. So this cannot happen anymore. We have already the resources, so why don't we make them more efficient?
But of course, rural landscapes have the advantage of having space to grow lots of crops. What could we actually do in cities?
Well, I mean, probably most of people already heard about urban farming. So it's a way to basically bring this concept of farming and growing food within the place where we live in cities. There are many ways to do that. Many people trying to do it on the rooftop or in the basement. Many other people are just trying to use a vertical configuration. What we are trying to do at Hexagro, we're trying to rethink the idea of what an indoor space is and put nature and food inside that so that we can grow food. At the same time, we can bring nature back into our lives.
And I know this is a big issue for you, the fact that we'd be around food in our daily lives. Why does that matter?
Well, I mean, if you think about our life as a Homo sapiens, let's say, we always lived outdoors in nature. We have it into our DNA. There is a science that is showing how beneficial is nature into our life. It's called biophilic design. And this is basically like when a dog is born and into DNA, he has written to be the best friend of humans. We have written in there into our DNA that we need to be into nature. Right now we're living in cities and we are completely deprived of nature. There is even a sickness that is called deprivation of nature. And it's making us not just sick in terms of a physical point of view, but also a mental point of view. So what we think is that why don't we bring food that we need to produce more into cities, but we bring it in a way that is also bringing us beneficial aspects for our mind and our feelings. And so why don't we bring the food production in the spaces where we live today?
Right, so let's come on to how you're aiming to deal with that particular problem, Hexagro. You've produced something.
Yeah, definitely. We are an hardware company. We make modular systems that are producing food. They are meant to be like a Lego system. We started many years ago with this concept of having a set of components that can then be assembled in many different ways that can fit different interiors, and also they can fit different crop types. So we got inspiration a lot from biomimicry. So the science of looking into nature and looking at patterns and looking at solutions that already work. Mm. And we found that already nature could provide us a solution. We created a product that you can see in the next image if you want, that is basically a modular structure that is created by these nodes. They're very similar to the nodes that are in trees, where new branches are growing up everywhere.
The knot, like
the knot, exactly,
knot, yeah.
And the shape that you see now is a shape that is inspired by the honeybee hives, so the hexagonal shape and the volume shape. So basically, you can produce a lot in a very minimum volume. Right now, this is the first configuration that we standardize. It's called the living farming tree. It looks really like a tree and actually is meant to be very interactive for people to grow and interact with the nature that is producing. Is using, this picture is showing you a very good example of it. The idea is that, of course, for just food production, you would need a very closed environment with very controlled parameters of also air quality and airflow. But right now we're focusing on trying to recreate this connection between people and in nature and the food that is itself produced in there. So that's why it's kind of looking open and is really meant for people to go there and touch. We want people to go there and smell, to have an experience back with the food, specifically because we believe that food is not just food that we use to put into our body to nourish ourselves, but is actually an experience. Many people think that the act of producing food is an act of care. Is an act of connecting very closely with this natural element that is from a seed is growing into a plant and then is giving us energy. And so that's what we're doing right now.
But how is it different from just having a plant in your office?
People tell us, we're discovering more and more that we're working with clients, that the difference between a normal plant and this product is that it's completely alive and it shows you that it's alive every time that you get in the office. Where it's unbelievable. Right now we're working with offices, mostly because as we live 90% of our life indoors in cities, 70% or 75% of this time when we are awake is spent in an office. So that's kind of like why we want to get in there first. And when people get into offices, they get reminded that the product is there because the lights, because of the interaction and the digital experience. And so compared to a traditional pot that you might forget, oh, maybe I have a planter, but I don't really remember and I need to water. In this case, the product is showing as a, let's say from a physical hardware perspective, is telling you that it's there from the lights, but it's also telling you that it's there from the UX, like from the digital experience that we are developing.
And this Hexagro unit has quite a big footprint to it. I mean, it takes up a fair bit of space, but yeah. I understand that's on purpose.
Yeah, it's on purpose. We decided to start with this first configuration, as I mentioned, because it's meant for creating a center of gravity. So you put it in the middle of a break area or a living room or a living space in general, and people will always gather around. We'll gather around because they're curious, and also because something there is happening. A life is happening, is growing. And so this is an excuse for then creating community around and making people speak and making people interact with each other.
It's like
during
the water cooler moment, right? We talk about that in an office where people will gather and chat.
Absolutely, yes. Yeah. We're trying to really rethink the idea of a break as well. Many people are telling us, I'm always getting stressed in office and the only thing I can think of is going downstairs and smoke a cigarette. Maybe we can actually give something a little bit more healthy, but specifically we can just use nature to recreate this sort of well-being feeling. It's unbelievable. I mean, there are studies that are showing that just 40 seconds of interaction with the plant can increase your focus by 4%.
Some people might look at this, though, and say, it's another headache for me to look after this in an office. I mean, they've got to deal with the soil, they've got to be watering these plants. You know, what do you say to all that?
Yeah, I mean, the system is completely automated. It's using a technology in terms of agronomy that is called high-pressure aeroponics. You can see a picture before in the deck, exactly that one. So there is no soil. And unbelievably, this is a technology that was developed by NASA in the 80s to grow food into other planets.
It's
currently the most efficient solution to produce food. It's saving up to 90, 95, some people even claim to be saving 98% of water compared to traditional farming. Mm. And this is because on one end, you recycle all the water into the system. So if it doesn't get up from the roots, it goes down into the reservoir and then it gets sprayed again. But mostly because of that sprayer, we have a high pressurized mist of nutrients and water. So there's basically microparticles of 50 microns that have been sprayed and they're attaching to the micro roots of the plant. It's mostly like spoon feeding a root. and giving them exactly the same quantity of nourishment that they need. They don't even have to spend energy on breaking down the particles. And so they grow very, very faster.
But surely you're limited in terms of range of what you could grow. You couldn't grow root vegetables here.
Yes, that's the crazy thing of aeroponics compared to hydroponics. Probably most people are familiar with that one. So like the plants and the roots are actually inside water.
In hydroponics.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Right now we don't have the roots into water. And so you can even grow the roots in that case. We have some clients that are growing potatoes. There are many other people around the world that are testing aeroponics with many other types of roots. So the idea is that you can really grow anything as long as you can adapt the hardware to the type of plant that you want to grow, and that's why we are modular. And you couldn't probably grow a tree because, of course, it doesn't make sense, but maybe the technology...
You got a tree already.
Yeah.
What about from this plate? What could you grow from there? Is that all achievable?
I think that all of them come from trees, so not really...
Not good.
Yeah.
What about this? Do you grow this?
Well, probably some of the ingredients, but not the same.
Okay. You told me that the system works so well that it could be the case that you come back after a weekend and the plants have doubled in size. How is that possible?
Yeah, because of this technology of aeroponics, because of the LED lighting. So you see the picture that is kind of pinky, more or less. So that's the mixture of red and blue lights. That are coming from the LEDs. Super efficient lighting system for the plants. And this combination, plus the environmental condition around, makes so that the plants are growing 3 to 5 times faster. And I mean, we are achieving, like, with the plant, with one plant planted on the system, we can harvest it 4 to 5 times in less than 3 months. So you can get, at the maximum productivity, you can harvest every 2-3 weeks. So compared to a traditional, probably, let's take basil, and you would be growing that plant and then harvesting in probably 2-3 months. So it's really faster. And the thing is that right now we're growing even much more than what we expected at the beginning. So we are building more the part of the experience of how to use these plants, because we notice working with our clients that not everybody knows exactly what to do with every single plant. So we really specialized on growing plants that you wouldn't find in the supermarket. Otherwise, it probably wouldn't make so much sense. And with them, we are working on growing more and more officinal plants, so plants that are providing you wellness effects immediately and that you can use for herbal tea, or you can just use as a break. Or an ingredient for your lunches or meals. And so based on this, we have a lot of people that are using the plants in different ways during the day.
The fact they're not grown in soil, does it somehow take something away from the nutrient quality?
Well, there are probably going to be people thinking that, although if we think about the soil, we should think about soil as a medium, right? So soil per se, specifically when there are no nutrients in the soil and we have a lot of problem with like desertification and soil degradation, that is a case where soil has nothing in there. So it's an empty medium and it is useless as much as is useless growing plants without the nutrients per se. So in this case, we provide all of the nutrients, all of the different resources that the plants need directly into the water that we spray. So there is absolutely no other need for having soil.
Okay, so you're concentrating on offices just now, and you talked a little bit about, well, you talked quite a lot about that, because it was, we spend most of our time there,
yeah.
It creates a social experience. When you try to sell this idea to offices, what are those your big selling points, the psychology, or is it the case that people don't really need to know that?
Sure, well, we must say that we happen to start with offices almost by chance. As a startup, I mean, you were trying to do many different things. Let's say who buys it, and actually an office bought it first. And when we installed it there, we thought that it was very important, the food aspect of it. But then we understood all of these aspects of community and people gathering around and this wellness aspect. And then we went deeper into studying this topic and we discovered that 76% of people are struggling with well-being while in the office space. Why? Because we are simply working in spaces that are not meant to have living beings live there, right? So if you just think about the fact that interiors have 5 times more pollutants than outdoors. Mm-hmm. Why? Because it's simply about the time of the exposure of your body to these elements. Yeah. They're not good for you. So we know that plants are good. Many companies, many people are using plants even to filtrate the air. For us right now, it's mostly about bringing experience. The experience of reconnecting to nature, the experience of bringing a wellness moment inside of these very stressful environments. And also, in many cases, when we work with HR people, so the people that are really worried about making their employees and making their coworkers feeling happier and more productive at work, we hear a lot the kind of a request on how do I make my people speak more, engage more within themselves? Because right now, when you get so stressed and just so kind of depressed, you happen to just work and think and live inside of your frame of computer. And then whenever the bells ring, you just go away. But we're actually seeing that the more systems there are, the more nature there is in an office, and the more people are restarting to bloom again and have these kind of interactions that are really healthy for us.
So you're saying aquaponics can grow plants faster?
Aeroponics, sorry.
It can grow plants faster, are awfully good for your health as well and your state of mind.
Yep.
Why aren't we doing more of it?
Well, I mean, the technology challenges are big. I mean, I can tell you from our experience of building an outdoor company, it's not easy. There are many companies doing that and they're doing a great job. We all should push even more into these kind of developments. It's a relatively new technology. I mean, being developed by NASA, the patents of that specific technology has been available for the rest of the world quite recently. So there are still few studies on that. We are actually working to improve that in the next years. But yes, I mean, we hope that there will be more. Our approach more and more that we develop in the future is that we really want and envision a set of components that can be used by anyone. So we don't really want to think of a closed system where we're just the ones providing the product and providing the solution, providing the technology and providing the new algorithms for the plants. But we really want to, I wouldn't say open source because probably people would just immediately think of a like open product just for hackers, but we really want to have something that anybody can play with, and eventually they can even become urban farmers. And so the idea for us is that all of the people that are moving into cities, they would like to still have something to do with agriculture or just with the reconnection to nature. And so why don't we create a network of these production centers, of just spaces that have some sort of production types, and then we have people interact within this ecosystem and they provide different services.
And do you have any ideas around like how that network might be developed? It's a really interesting
idea. I mean, if you think of any other decentralized network, it's quite easy right now. I mean, we wouldn't be the ones inventing it. I mean, Uber and Airbnb are the best example, right? The only difference is that right now we don't have unused cars or unused houses to rent or to drive. We actually need to build the machines first. So we're focusing on building that, of being like a very solid infrastructure, also in terms of not just the hardware per se, but also in terms of the services that we can provide to the people using these systems. And then out of here, we're going to slowly start increasing and opening, let's say, the market. So right now we're working with offices. We hope that we're going to be able to work with private individuals in their homes as soon as possible. Very likely we're going to start working with real estate developers. There is a huge trend right now into everything that is sustainable buildings construction, not just like a LEED certification, let's say, on the shelf and on the environmental impact, but also on the quality of the people that are living inside of this building. So the trend is going there. If we think about smart cities, the first picture that you have is a city full of nature, I guess. So that's going to be for sure. Probably it's not just going to be nature per se. It's not going to be nature just for an aesthetical point of view. It must be nature that also provides you something more. Something more is food in this case for us.
The scene is set for this to go big, is what you're saying.
Yep.
I'm going to ask you in just a couple of minutes' time a few more questions about where you see the future for this type of technology. But before I do that, let me just say to the folks watching online that there's so much going on at the DIF today. Is the last of the five live days that we're doing this week. Anything you've missed up to this point, you can watch back at thinkdiff.co. And to tell you about a few of the sessions that you really should see, here's one of my colleagues right now.
Hey guys, Lou here with a couple of my favourite sessions available on Catch Up from this week. First off, how the circular economy tackles climate change. In this session, we explored how business leaders, policymakers, and investors can build a thriving and resilient economy while playing an essential role in reaching climate targets. Secondly, the very popular power of data and information in cities. In this session, we looked at how citizens can harness their city's data and use it to address local problems. Remember, you can join the discussion on Twitter using the hashtag ThinkDiff, and you can catch up on anything you've missed and view the full schedule at thinkdiff.co, or check out the Ellen MacArthur Foundation's YouTube channel.
Okay, you're back in the live studio. I'm here with Alessandro Grampa, who's talking to us about urban farming and the potential of growing food in our workplaces, in our lives. Alessandro, you've been showing us the Hexagro unit here. Yeah. We've been talking about how this can be utilized in offices and how this can be good for people's state of mind and for a sense of community. But you think they can be utilized in other spaces too?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we can't just focus on wellness. We can't just focus on making something that is nice. We need to think about how we're gonna feed the 7 billion people living in cities. And this product alone won't do it, that's for sure.
It'd have to be bigger than that.
Yeah, it must be a bit bigger. What is very interesting for us is that following biomimicry, following this concept of having minimum basic components that can be reassembled in different ways and scaled up almost infinitely, we can really think of different ways to bring nature and food in all other interiors that we're currently not using. So just think of, I don't know, like a hallway in a metro line. Probably in London they're too busy, so there wouldn't be space, but in many other places where they're much bigger, then you just have a couple of people passing by and all around is wall. Wall maybe adds, right? Just imagine, how could it be having a line of systems that are producing food and they're maybe just producing the right food that you are going to pick that day because it knows your schedule coming back from home while you're commuting, right? So all of these concepts of technology, you can really feed them into anything as long as you're working with data. And so right now we're working with collection of data on plants, people, places. So all of these will work and will be so big that we're literally going to use them for understanding what's going to be the best way to produce food later on. And also what are going to be the tastes of people. Because the other problem that really drove us from the very beginning of why didn't we go just making a warehouse? Why didn't we go centralized? I mean, nature teaches us that rather than maximizing on one single species, we need to optimize on the maximum diversity that we can have in an ecosystem because diversity means resiliency.
Yes.
So when we are thinking of this, we can't think of just producing lettuce on a massive scale. What's gonna happen when people don't want a lettuce anymore? Are you just gonna throw the warehouse away?
Or some sort of bug perhaps gets into that
system. I
don't know,
yeah, right? Of course. I mean, everything is going into decentralization. I mean, from data to finance to everything, why food can't, right? So the idea for us is really to build the set of components, ship them or just let and allow everybody to use them in whatever ways they want. There may be things that we don't even know that if we just allow people to do what they want, they will innovate 10,000 times better than our engineers could think of, right?
Nice point. And you do want to take this into people's homes, but that requires a different style of, of product, I believe.
Yeah, of course. I mean, we already have into development more compact and vertical configurations. So imagine the idea of having your IKEA shelf that is not just holding books, but is maybe also producing food. These kind of ideas that we have into our big brainstorming pot. The cool thing of it is that with this model of innovation, with this biomimicry model, we already have 80% of the components of new products. We don't go product A, we sell it, and then, okay, maybe people don't want it anymore, let's go product B and we sell it again. It's mostly like a complete cost on iteration. We use tons of exponential technologies like 3D printing that allow us that not to be bound by one single shape because we already invested so much money on an injection mold. We can always change and iterate. So our team is focusing right now on always focusing on the most modular solution that can happen, taking into consideration the technology will evolve exponentially fast. And of course, right now we can't produce the 3D printed system at once because it would be more expensive, but technology will be cheaper, technology will be more available. So for sure, there will be a time where you're just gonna download your design and you're just gonna print it next to your home. You don't even need to ship it from, I don't know, Italy, where we are based right now.
Folks watching at home who are interested in problems or more to the point, solutions within our food system might be interested to know the Ellen MacArthur Foundation produced this report earlier this year, which is full of ideas about how we could be growing our food more effectively and serving the needs of people who will be living in cities, of course. One of the predictions that we make in here, or one of the research points, is that we think we can produce up to a third of our food inside of cities. It requires quite a lot of change, and there's some details behind that in here. Are you optimistic we could get to a third?
We're definitely going to get to a third.
Definitely, I like that.
I'm not so much of a researcher on this topic specifically, so I couldn't tell you if we can even go more. We're definitely going to try to completely, drastically change the way that you access food. That's for sure. And who knows, maybe we're also gonna go into a direction where we're only gonna eat certain foods that are produced in urban farming technologies ways or others. Who knows? I mean, definitely future, we are positive. We are very, very optimistic. We think that there's never been a time like this one in terms of technology development and fast changement, let's say in fast change of this kind of technology. So for sure, there will be something very good to see in the next years.
And as you said too, a mindset shift about health and well-being for people who are occupying all of these spaces. One final question I'm gonna leave you with. You're speaking to a CEO who has offices.
Yep.
What's your selling point? Give us three selling points of taking a technology like this.
So very basically, what we say is that we, as Hexagro, grow plants. We grow plants for people's wealth and well-being. And by this, we gather data. We gather data because experiences are created and these kind of experiences are kind of monitored by different sensors and different digital points where we gather this kind of user data. And based on this, we're able to provide reports on how people are actually feeling like. So we work very much with HR people and CEOs because they are worried of not knowing how people feel into their workplace. They are obliged to do maybe at the end of the year or every couple of years a huge report analysis on how the workforce is feeling when maybe the problem is starting much, much before. So what we're trying to do is to have always a data-driven approach. For us, it's important to develop the plants topic because, of course, we grow plants and we want to do it as good as we can. On the other end, people are interested on the people, on people interaction with these plants and on how people are interacting with other people within the workplace or within their own lives. And so that's what we do today. And we hope that many other company managers and directors and leaders will believe in what we're doing. And we'll have plenty of indoor farms inside of their offices.
Nice, Alessandro. But this time, and pardon the pun, give me a bite-sized response. Why is aeroponics the way ahead?
That's a good question. I mean, is the most efficient in terms of energy usage, water usage, and speed of growth. So that's been developed not by us, but by people that are real scientists to go into real impossible missions like space. So we believe in them. And so far, we've been lucky on following their direction.
Alessandro, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay, don't know about you watching this at home, but I'm off to speak to our office manager about installing a food growing system in our office. Thank you very much for watching this Diff show. There's so much more on at thinkdiff.co, so go watch stuff you maybe missed earlier this week. Okay, it's goodbye from me.
We need to start making more conscious material choices.
We set up an initiative called Make Fashion Circular.
It's a tsunami of change.